Hi everyone and welcome to part 9 of To Be Astronomer Reacts to a Geocentrist Movie. We have found out in the last part that they also misconstrued Edwin Hubble's quotes and actually used well-known tricks at the time where people were, especially creationists in the early 2000s, were misquoting Edwin Hubble. I have put you a nice link in the description of part 8 and me also do so for part 9, where you can read up on exactly how misrepresentative this quote is. It is completely taken out of context. Edwin Hubble here talks actually about because his observations allowed for only two possible outcomes. One is that the universe is expanding and that it is homogeneous and isotropic. And the other is that it's not expanding and all of the galaxies are just moving away from Earth, right? And he then talks about the distribution of galaxies and what it would mean. And he says that this hypothesis cannot be falsified, which in science terms essentially means that it's dead. And he said that it should only consider if the earlier way of resolving his observations leads to contradictions, which it very much hasn't. You can read it up, all of the things. Again, I'm not all too deep into cosmology. I know very little about the distribution of galaxies. I have tried to read up on it. Just read up on it yourself. And so they have misquoted him, essentially. Let's keep on going.
The universe, analogous in a sense to the ancient conception of a central Earth. This hypothesis cannot be disproved, but it is unwelcome and would only be accepted as a last resort in order to save the phenomena. Therefore, we disregard this possibility. The unwelcome position of a favored location must be avoided at all costs. Such a favored position is intolerable.
Hubble never believed in the expanding universe because he had the wrong value of the Hubble constant.
Hubble constant.
The Hubble didn't really believe in much of anything as far as I know. He was very much an observer. He left the theoretical interpretations of his observations to the theorists. He just observed, and very cleverly at that, he did very interesting surveys that he found a way to work around the missing calibrations for a few of his measurements, because he actually measured the galaxy density in one square degree and per magnitude, which is an indication of brightness. It's complicated. I'm sure you can read it up there.
The presumed rate at which space is created and galaxies are believed to be moving away from each other.
Space is not created. It's already there. It's just expanding.
In the expanding universe theory.
Now, it's one of the most important numbers in cosmology, because once we know how fast a galaxy a million light years away from us is moving, simple physics to work backwards and figure out how long ago we were together.
But that left the centrality issue unsolved. A new idea would...
There never was a centrality issue.
...be required.
Friedman came up with the expanding models, which have this kind of paradoxical property that they're spatially homogeneous and isotropic, so everything looks the same everywhere and everything looks the same in every direction everywhere, and therefore...
Exactly. Space, this is known as the cosmological principle, I believe, is homogenic and isotropic. Homogenic means that it looks the same in each direction. Homogenic means that it looks the same to each neutral observer. And isotropic means that it also looks the same in every direction, right? So if we look at this region in the sky, it looks roughly the same, like on the large scale, as in the other direction. There aren't significantly more galaxies in one direction, and so on and so forth.
Well, from your viewpoint, it looks as if everything is expanding away from you. From every other galaxy's viewpoint, it looks as if everything is expanding away from you.
You can say that they're being expanded because you see their redshift.
People that believe in the expansion of the universe claim that it's like a muffin with raisins embedded.
Exactly as the Copernican principle requires. Imagine a case...
They are once again pretending here that we came to this conclusion because of the Copernican principle. We didn't. So those are two different kinds. And even if we did, it is ultimately not important. What is important is that as of yet, this interpretation of the cosmological principle has not led to any major contradictions. Not even minor contradictions that I'm aware of. So it's fine.
in an oven with raisins. As the dough rises...
This is what I explained in the last part about... I like the analogy with the balloon better because I can imagine it more easily, but you can also do it a cake with raisins, where the distance from each raisin to the next raisin increases as the muffin or the cake expands due to the baking powder.
The raisins move apart from each other, just as galaxies would move away from each other on the surface of a balloon.
Ah, yes, there it is.
So if you curve it, and you put these galaxies on the surface of that curve, and then you expand it.
If you're big enough that anywhere you look, it's expanding at the same rate from that spot.
Relativity tells us that in the presence of mass and energy, space can curve. Space is dynamical. It can bend, it can expand, it can contract. And one of the great holy grails of cosmology, in fact, the reason I got into cosmology originally as a particle physicist, was to determine which kind of universe we live in, because the fact that the universe is curved means it can exist in one of three different forms, so-called closed, open, or flat.
That is true. Measurements as of yet, if I remember correctly from my cosmology courses, the universe as we know it is geometrically flat. So it is neither closed nor open. You can see that apparently from the cosmic microwave background.
The bottom line is experiment. We can simply speculate as much as we want about this great universe of ours, but the bottom line is you have to look at the data. The data exactly. Show that the universe seems to be remarkably flat.
Yes.
And how do you get a flat universe from a Big Bang? Well, one possibility is inflation. In fact, it is the simplest way to get a flat universe.
Inflation, the hypothesis that the universe had, at its very beginning, an extremely rapid exponential expansion that exceeded the limit on the speed of light set by the special theory of relativity.
What they're trying to misrepresent again. I mean, why should space not be able to go faster than the speed of light? The only thing that special relativity says is that nothing within space can travel faster than light in a vacuum. Within space, nothing is said about space itself. Space itself can expand at any rate at which it goddamn wants, as far as we know.
Resulting in a space that is flat and homogeneous.
Think of a balloon and put a bump on it. The bump thinks that the balloon is flat because he's very small and the balloon is very big. However, it's a balloon. It is curved. However, it looks flat only because the bug is very small. We are the bugs.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. Lift off.
Be juke and go to the moon.
I so much hope that we are getting into space denial now, or like moon landing denial, because I'd have a much easier and less time-consuming experience with getting rid of these things than with cosmology.
Coming on the heels of Hubble's discoveries, observations in the middle part of the 20th century showed that spiral galaxies didn't appear to be obeying the laws of gravity.
Several decades ago, we found...
This is not only in spiral galaxies, this applies to elliptical galaxies too. So the thing that people started doing, right, was that they were doing what's called... I mean, that there are many ways in which you can come to the conclusion of dark matter. That's where they're going, I assume. There are many ways in which you can arrive there. The one that we were being taught as the kind of the go-to way is that you have rotational diagrams, which is where you plot on the y-axis you have the rotational speed, and at the so how fast it is rotating around the center that the of the galaxy, and at the x-axis you have the distance to the center of the galaxy. And interestingly enough, we expected something that we very much didn't get, and it seemed that a lot of mass has to be at the very edges of the galaxy. So however, the farther we go out in your average galaxy, the less things we can see over there. So first of all, it was considered that gravity works different at large scales, which turned out to be not the case. And as of now, we think that there is something called dark matter that interacts with probably only the fundamental force of gravity, and maybe either the strong or the weak nuclei, which we wouldn't be able to measure properly. and not with electromagnetism. So there's something out there that by its very nature we cannot see that is, that does have mass, which is a horrible thing for observational astronomers to figure out. I get headaches when I think about
it. Found a problem so great that it was brushed under the carpet for many a decade. And this is the fact that galaxies spin too fast. We believe in the work of...
This is what the rotational diagram thing was. At first it was believed to be some kind of measurement error, because to be frank with you, the measuring the rotational speeds of stars in other galaxies is very difficult. It is also very difficult for our galaxy. In the beginning they figured it might just be strange observations that aren't really true, but we know today that they very much are true.
Of Isaac Newton, at least on planetary scales, but when you apply Newton's laws of motion to the galaxy spins too fast. In fact, 10 times too fast. By rights, the galaxy should fly apart. Therefore, scientists said that we have to have dark matter, a halo of matter that surrounds the galaxy and holds the galaxy together.
Yes.
Dark matter, hypothesized form of matter introduced to allow conventional theories of gravity to explain the observed anomalies in galaxy rotation and expansion.
I mean, if you're going to use Newton's law...
In principle, it's a bit more complicated than that. Obviously, there are many ideas surrounding dark matter. And as they said very correctly, we do not have strong evidence for dark matter yet from either, particle standpoint of view. We are not sure what dark matter is made out of. Some people think it may be completely new fundamental particles, like new quarks, new particles that we have not detected yet. Other people think that it is made out of quarks we already know, but then we wouldn't know of which, because none of the particles that we know would really have all of the properties that dark matter probably should have. So very much from a small scale point of view, quantum or particle physics, dark matter is still very much on the hypothetical side, right? From an astronomical standpoint, it explains quite a lot, dark matter does. So from an astronomical standpoint, we are rather sure that there is dark matter, really.
F equals ma, and you're going to use Einstein's tensor equation, then you better have the matter and energy in the universe to make it work. But it ain't there.
Between 1 and 3% of
the... You better have the matter and energy in the universe to make it work. But it ain't there.
I'm not sure what he's trying to say with that. First of all, I wouldn't use Newton's laws of motion on a galaxy. Galaxies are so large in scale and with such vast masses that Newton would probably not work on these scales anymore. I'd go for general relativity. The thing is that our predictions of how much dark matter there should be come from general relativity. So when he says that general relativity doesn't work, that's kind of not true, because we get the ideas of how much there should be from general relativity.
Between 1 and 3% of the universe is all the stuff we can see, and you know, somewhere between 99 and 97% of the universe is stuff we can't see.
Thereabouts, yes.
This dark matter that dominates our galaxy, we think, we're virtually certain now, is made of some new type of elementary particle, different than the stuff that makes you and I up.
And what have they discovered? Absolutely nothing. Zip.
That is true. We have, discovered very little. This is mostly due to... I would kind of blame the particle physicists for that. This is not blame in the sense that they don't work properly. Quite the opposite. They really, really try to look out for dark matter. The problem there is that we don't know how much energy we need to find dark matter. And the next problem is that at the region where we are in the galaxy, there should only be extremely little dark matter. So really, in the farther out you get, the more dark matter there is. But we are still in the part where it's not super problematic yet, so there's not a lot of dark matter around, you know. So this is really, as far as we know, this is really the problem with figuring it out.
A bit perturbing is that after 50 years we still haven't found what the dark matter is. But on the other hand, that doesn't mean they're not there, it just means they're harder to find than we thought.
Exactly. Why? if we can't find something after 50 years that doesn't really indicate much of anything. People have looked for an atom for over 2,000 years when we think about it, that Leukippe in ancient Greece has already hypothesized about atoms and was and he said he can't see any really, which, I mean, big surprise. It took us like 2,000 years to see atoms. So if we can't find anything after 50 years in science, this is by no means the absence of evidence is no evidence of absence, right? That's the important thing here. Oh, 15 minutes again already. Well, thank you for watching. I hope you enjoyed it. And please do consider giving this video a like or even subscribing and all of the other things that people do on YouTube. Thank you so much for watching, and until the next time.